In the previous class, we were discussing about the lumped parameter approach of solving the unsteady state heat conduction problems. Now, the lumped approach essentially neglects the spatial variation of temperature within the system, but there are certain problems where the spatial variation of temperature within the system is important, and there you have to solve the temperature distribution as a combined function of position and time, not just time but also a function of position and time. So we will discuss about such problems today. So we will discuss about first one dimensional unsteady state heat conduction. Now it is a general broad topic, and we will try to understand this particular issue with the help of some problems. So we will first consider one problem. Of something called as infinite slab. So what is this? Let us say we have a slab which has a thickness of 2L and the direction in which it has a thickness of 2L is x direction. The other directions, like these directions, are this direction and the direction perpendicular to the plane of the figure are infinitely large. Because they are infinitely large, the gradients along those directions are very small, and therefore the corresponding second order derivative terms are neglected in the corresponding heat conduction equation. So if we do that, we will come up with a simplified equation, but because we are working with a problem, let us give the boundary conditions and then we will solve the problem. So let us say that the temperature here is T equal to T0. We will first work out a problem when both the temperatures are same. If the temperatures are different, I will not work out that problem, but I will give you some idea that based on what consideration you can solve the problem even if the temperatures are not the same. But to begin with, let us consider that these two temperatures are equal, which is T equal to T0. So considering that all the thermophysical properties are constant, so let us first write the energy equation. Plus, let us say we put a term for heat generation. Now, let us try to see that which terms of this equation are negligible as compared to the other terms. Let us look into that. So this slab is much wider and much longer in height as compared to the thickness. So the gradients along y and z directions are neglected. This is also neglected. If these are neglected and also we do not have any heat generation, so this term is 0. Then how do we solve this problem? We solve this problem by considering that kx is a constant. If kx is a variable, it is not so easy to solve it analytically. So we assume that this is our governing differential equation. Okay. See, there is a very interesting thing. When we solve this problem, we say that we are assuming all thermophysical properties as constant. But you can see that actually taking k as constant is good enough. It doesn't depend, it doesn't matter whether rho Cp are constant or whatever, because anyway rho Cp come out of the derivative, right? So rho Cp, or for a solid Cp becomes C, rho into C comes out of the derivative, not because it rho and C are constant, but because of some other simplifications which we have already taken care of when we derived the energy equation. So this equation has an assumption that k is constant, but it doesn't have an assumption that rho C are constants. Right. So this is very elusive, because rho C out of the derivative may create an illusion that as if rho and C are constants, but these are not constants. Okay. So this is the governing differential equation. Now this is a time dependent problem. So these kind of problems in the theory of differential equations are called as initial boundary value problems. So you require initial conditions to specify that at time equal to 0, what is the situation. So initial condition at t equal to 0, temperature is equal to Ti for all x. This is, let us say, initial temperature. And boundary condition, now you can play a little bit of trick by reducing the size of the domain. You can see that this problem is symmetrical, right? On this side, on this end, whatever is the temperature, at this end also the same temperature is there. So it is symmetrical with respect to the central axis. So always when we say symmetry, we have to keep in mind that we are talking about symmetry in geometry and symmetry in boundary condition. So here we have both symmetry in geometry and symmetry in boundary condition. Okay. So now, because of symmetry, you can solve half of the domain. Let us put the origin here as x equal to 0. Whatever is the solution that we get for half of the domain, the remaining this half will be symmetrical solution. So we can reduce the size of the problem. For analytical solution, it doesn't matter that much. But if you are solving the problem computationally or numerically, so I mean reducing the total domain size will reduce your computational cost. That is, you will require less number of grid points to solve the problem and so on. So computational time and computational cost will be less. So now, can you tell What will be the boundary condition here? It should be partial derivative of t with respect to x equal to 0, right? So at x equal to 0, you have this, and at x equal to L, t equal to t 0. See, you can make this problem very nicely tractable by method of separation of variables by transforming even both the boundary conditions to be homogeneous. Right, if you define theta equal to t minus t 0, then this will give you theta equal to 0 at x equal to 0. So let us recast the problem by writing theta is equal to t minus t 0. So boundary condition at x equal to 0 at x equal to L, theta equal to 0, and the governing differential equation okay. Now we will use the method of separation of variables. So theta is equal to let us say that theta is a product of a function of x and a function of time. So you have g dash f g dash is equal to alpha f double dash g from this. All right. So f double dash by f is equal to g dash by alpha g. Now when you write this equation, this is a function of x only, right? This is a function of t only. So function of x only is equal to a function of t only, that means each must be a constant. Now the question is whether the constant is a positive constant or a negative constant. That we have to carefully figure out. Again, if you make a mistake, as I told you that there are two ways of figuring it out. One way is the hard way, that let us say you make a mistake, you will see that it will not eventually satisfy your initial or boundary conditions. But there is a simple physical way of figuring it out. See, this is dg dt, right? So dg by g, if you integrate it, it will be ln of g. So that will be equal to this alpha into the constant into T. So what is G? G is the time dependence of the problem. Eventually, as you allow the time as T tends to infinity, what will happen? The time dependent part of the solution will vanish because it will attain a steady state. In the limit as time tends to infinity, this problem will attain a steady state. Because this problem will attain a steady state, what it will mean? It will mean that the unsteady part of the solution will decay with time, right? Because it will decay with time and G will be an exponential function of T, a negative constant will imply an exponential decay. Otherwise, it will be an exponential rise. So therefore, we can say that this is equal to minus lambda square, okay? So now let us apply the boundary conditions. Before applying the boundary conditions, let us see the solution. So dg dt 1 by alpha g dg by g is what? Ln of g is equal to minus alpha lambda square t plus ln of some constant c1. So g is equal to c1 into e to the power minus alpha lambda square t. Okay. Now, what is the solution for f? What is the solution for f? Yes. Cos and sin, right? So c2 cos lambda x plus c3 sin the solution is related to the product of f and g. Now let us apply the boundary conditions. Boundary condition number 1, at x equal to 0, del theta del x equal to 0, this boundary condition. So that means basically df dx will be equal to 0. So if you make df dx, cos will become sin and sin will become cos. Of course, plus minus I am not bothering. So cos will become sin. So at x equal to 0, that term is automatically equal to 0, and the derivative of this will be cos. So at x equal to 0, you have c3 x equal to 0. If f has to be 0, then c3 must be equal to 0, right? Because if c3 is not equal to 0, then the entire solution is a trivial solution. That is, if f equal to 0, the solution itself is 0, okay? So the solution The next is at x equal to L, theta equal to 0. At x equal to L, theta equal to 0. So at x equal to L, theta equal to 0 means you have C2 cos lambda L equal to 0. Again, here C2 cannot be 0, because if both C1 and C2 are 0, then what happens? Then it results in a trivial solution, right? So only possibility is that cos lambda L equal to 0, okay. So cos lambda L equal to 0. That means lambda L is 2n plus 1 into pi by 2. Because there are infinite such possible values of n, you have infinite such possible values of lambda. So each lambda is denoted by lambda with subscript n. So lambda n is equal to 2n plus 1 into pi by 2l. This is the lambda. This is the so called eigenvalue of that problem. Now the solution theta is, you have C3 equal to 0, so C2 cos lambda x into C1 e to the power minus alpha lambda square t. This is the solution, but we have to keep in mind that there are n such possible values of lambda. For each value of lambda, this is the solution. So for n such possible values, you have summation of these for over n, that should be the solution. That is because of the linearity of the governing differential equation. So the total solution is a sum total of the solution for each possible value of lambda, and lambda will have infinite number of possible values. So now in place of C1 into C2, let us write this as Cn e to the power minus alpha lambda n square t into cos okay. So the only part of the problem that remains is to calculate what is Cn. If we find out what is Cn, then that completes the solution of the problem. So how do we calculate Cn? To calculate Cn, we will refer to this equation. So we will write okay. Now we basically need to derive an orthogonality condition. In the context of two dimensional steady state problem, we discussed what is an orthogonality condition, and similar orthogonality condition will be derivable here. So how do we proceed towards deriving the orthogonality condition? Remember, the objective of deriving the orthogonality condition is we can isolate Cn, and we can figure out that for one value of m equal to n only, that is non-zero, and for other cases the coefficient of Cn becomes 0. So that out of the summation you can isolate the Cn from the summation. So now, so what we did, we multiplied it by Fm and integrated by parts. So the same thing we will do here. So dx, then this is a higher order derivative, so this we will put as second function and this we will put as first function. So first function, this is second function. So first function into integral of the second, minus integral of derivative of first into integral of the second, certain simplifications we can make. See, this boundary term at x equal to 0, you have dfn dx equal to 0, right, because del theta del x equal to 0, and at x equal to L you have theta equal to 0, that means f equal to 0. So that brings this entire boundary term equal to 0, and that is why we actually had to use the homogeneous boundary conditions, so that the homogeneous boundary condition cleans up this boundary term. Either this equal to 0 or this equal to 0, either of these are homogeneous boundary conditions. So that leads to the product equal to 0, and this term goes away. Now next, what we do, we write the same equation but swap n and m. So swap n and m. And then subtract. If we subtract, then what will happen? This term will be 0, I mean they will get cancelled, and you will have lambda n square minus lambda m square integral of fn fm dx from 0 to L equal to 0. So this leads to integral of fn fm dx 0 to L is equal to 0 if m is not equal to n, and is not equal to 0 if m equal to n. This is the so called orthogonality condition, where fn is what? Fn is cos lambda n x, right, and lambda n is given by this equation. So we can now attempt to find out what is Cn by applying the initial condition. So far as our solution is concerned, we have used only the boundary condition. We have not yet used the initial condition. So at initial condition, at time equal to 0, theta equal to say theta I, which is T I minus T 0. So theta I is equal to summation of C n cos lambda n x. So what we will do? We will multiply both sides by cos lambda m x, f n into f m, and then integrate. So theta I cos lambda m x dx okay. Now by the orthogonality condition, this product, integral of this product is 0 if m is not equal to n. Only in one case it is non-zero, when m is equal to n. So this series will eventually be only one term, one non-zero term. So that non-zero term, if you isolate, that means you can write Cn integral of cos square lambda n x dx 0 to L is equal to integral of theta I cos lambda n x dx. Right? So this will tell you what is Cn. That completes the solution of the problem, because once you know Cn, you can substitute that here to get theta. And see, this solution is very general, because if the initial temperature is a function of position, then also you can solve this problem. If the initial temperature is a constant, then you just need to take this out of the integral. Otherwise, if this is a function of x, you just put it as a function of x. I am not going into the integration of sine, cosine and all these terms. These are all high school level stuff, and we should not waste time here. We should better use the time to develop physical insight now into the solution, right? So let us try to do that. So now let us try to see that if you want to plot the solution of this problem, how will the solution look? Let us say this is the domain. Of course, this is infinitely long, but I have just truncated it and drawn it like this. So if you consider the center line, first of all, it is, the solution is symmetric with respect to the center line. So at very early times, the solution may be something like this. Right? At very early times. Then the solution becomes this as you progress with time. And eventually, if you go for time tends to infinity, what will be the solution? It will be uniform throughout, right? Because there is no heat source. So as time tends to infinity, then the steady state solution will be what? A constant, right? So this is progressing time. Initially, there will be a difference between, see, the slab has an initial temperature. and you have subjected it to a boundary condition. So what will happen? There will be a difference between these two, and that difference will trigger some heat transfer. But that difference will be slowly nullified as you are proceeding with time. In the limit, as time tends to infinity, that time dependent solution goes away. So when you have the time dependent solution gone, then you will be basically having just the spatial dependence of temperature. Okay. Now this you can plot also in terms of the non-dimensional number. We have discussed about this, which is Fourier number. So sometimes to make a non-dimensional representation, instead of t, you plot it as a function of alpha t by L square. We discussed that alpha t by L square, this is the Fourier number, this is t by L square by alpha. So this is the time divided by the diffusion time, heat diffusion time. Okay. In fact, the entire solution, the time dependent solution, you can write it as a function of two non-dimensional numbers, the Biot number and the Fourier number. You should try to make an attempt to write the solution in terms of the non-dimensional numbers, Biot number and Fourier number. We have defined both of these numbers in our previous lecture. The next point is that what will be the change in solution if we change the boundary condition? For example, we have considered both the ends to be at the same temperature T0, but let us say this end is at a different temperature than this. Then you cannot directly use the method of superposition of variables. So what you have to do is basically you divide the problem into two problems. One problem is when both the ends are at the same temperature, then you solve in this way, and with that superimposed another problem when there is a differential of the temperatures of the two ends and a steady state solution of that. Okay. So let us say that this end is T0 and this end is T0 dash. So one problem is that you solve a steady state problem when this T0 dash, T0, let us say an example with T0 not equal to T0 dash. So you can solve a steady state problem by considering this gradient, and there you do not consider any unsteadiness. The entire unsteadiness you dump on another problem where you have both the ends at the same temperature, and then the total solution is a linear superposition of the two solutions, where for the second problem where you solve the unsteady problem you can use this method. For the steady problem it's a simple one dimensional steady state heat conduction. So the net solution is the sum total of the two solutions. You have to be a little bit careful of how to give initial condition for the unsteady problem, but that I leave on you as an exercise. Let us say that instead of having a given temperature boundary condition, we have another problem where we use a given convective heat transfer coefficient boundary condition. Let us say same infinite slab. Let us say that some fluid is flowing outside the slab with heat transfer coefficient H and temperature T infinity. Okay. So only difference from the previous problem is that there is a different boundary condition. Previous problem, what type of boundary condition is it was? It was a Dirichlet type of boundary condition where the temperature was specified. What type of boundary condition is now there for this problem? What is the boundary condition here? what is the boundary condition at this surface? So physically, what is the boundary condition? Whatever is the rate at which heat is transferred here, at the same rate heat is transferred from here to the surroundings. Let us say that the system is at a greater temperature than the surroundings. So that means minus, this is x equal to L, this is x equal to 0, minus k del t del x at x equal to L is equal to h into t at x equal to L minus t infinity. Okay. Now again the confusion always remains is that we are assuming that it's an unsteady state problem. Still we are assuming that the rate at which heat is transferred here is the same rate at which heat gets transferred to the surroundings. So is there any kind of inconsistency between this and the consideration of unsteady state? There is no inconsistency, because a surface cannot store thermal energy. Doesn't matter whether it is steady or unsteady, surface cannot store thermal energy. So at whatever rate heat is transferred to the surface, at that instant, at the same rate heat will be transferred from that surface. Okay. So this boundary condition is the only difference between the previous problem and this problem. So let us work out that, let us try to follow the solution of the previous problem and then see what are the changes. So at x equal to 0, del theta del x, here also we can solve half of the domain. And at x equal to L, here we define theta as t minus t infinity. Right, minus k del theta del x is equal to h into theta, theta is t minus t infinity, this at x equal to L. So this is the only change, and let us quickly see how this change is reflected in the solution. So this part of the solution remains the same, because this is before applying the boundary conditions. So before applying the boundary conditions, whatever was the solution, general solution is the same. So ultimately your general solution is, when we apply the boundary condition, so theta is summation of Cn e to the power minus alpha lambda n square t into cos lambda n x. How did we get this solution? We get this solution by substituting this boundary condition, right? And this boundary condition doesn't change from the previous problem to this problem. So this form is fine, but lambda n is different. So how do you get lambda n? You have to use the second boundary condition. Minus k remember that when you are differentiating with respect to x, only f is important, not g, because g is not function of x, right? So minus k this will be basically dfn dx. Dfn dx is d dx of cos lambda nx, and this is h into theta. Theta will eventually be f, g gets cancelled from both sides. Okay, so minus k, okay, minus will get cancelled. So k lambda n sin lambda n l is equal to h cos lambda n l. So you can write cot lambda n l is equal to lambda n l by h l by k, right? All right. So we have, what we have done is we have multiplied by l because we want to use the non-dimensional number, the Bayer number. Bayer number is h l by k. So cot lambda n l is equal to lambda n l by Bayer number based on l. So this is the eigenvalue. See, the eigenvalue determination is not very straightforward, because this is a transcendental equation. It is, if you want to get a graphical feel of the solution, then we can draw it here. So this is lambda n l, right? Lambda n l. Pi, 2 pi, like that we can sketch. So cot lambda n l will be something like this, right? In this way you will have infinite number of such segments, and the other solution, the other part of the solution is this is lambda n l by Bayer number. This is y equal to mx. Y equal to mx, a straight line passing through the origin. So these points of intersection are the eigenvalues. So if you are familiar with MATLAB, what you can do in MATLAB, you can draw the graph of cot lambda l, and you may, or say cot x, and you may draw the graph of x by Bayer number and find out the points of intersection. Those points of intersection are the eigenvalues of this problem. So these are not, for the previous problem this was like a straightforward 2n plus 1 into pi by 2. For this problem it has to be obtained from this. Now what about the constant cn? So we will quickly see. How to get the constant Cn? Because we have got lambda n. See, all these problems are eigenvalue problems. Just like in linear algebra, you require to, in eigenvalue problems, you require to find out the eigenvalue and eigenvector. Similarly, in differential equation, you require to find out the eigenvalue and eigenfunction. So, eigenvalue we have already determined. Now, the eigenfunctions are related by orthogonality condition, and we have to derive the orthogonality condition here. So we will use this fm into dfn dx why I am separately writing here is because here the boundary condition is different. So we have to make sure that we derive the orthogonality condition freshly from the boundary condition of this problem. So what is the boundary condition of this problem? At x equal to 0 it is the same. So at x equal to 0 this term is 0, but at x equal to L this term is not 0, right? At x equal to L what is this term? Minus k dfn dx equal to h into fn, right? This is minus k del theta del x equal to h into theta. This is at x equal to L. So what will this become? In place of dfn dx we will have minus h by k fn fm. Right? Because at x equal to 0 anyway dfn dx is 0. At x equal to L it is not 0, but dfn dx is related to fn. Okay? So we have written this. Now what we will do? We will swap n and n and subtract. And you can see because of the symmetry in fn and fm this term will be cancelled. So that is why, see, eventually sometimes ignorance is a blessing. If you do formula based study then you need not go through it, you eventually know orthogonality condition will come some way or the other. So you eventually write only the orthogonality condition, but there may be a tricky boundary condition when orthogonality condition itself is not satisfied. And then you cannot use the separation of variable method to solve that problem. So for every typical boundary condition you have to look for the orthogonality condition. Here fortunately the orthogonality condition can be obtained because when you swap m and n and subtract this term will be 0, right? So eventually you will get this. So although you get the same final answer for the orthogonality condition so far as the orthogonality condition is concerned, but the route of getting that orthogonality condition is different for different problems. Okay, and then the remaining solution is very similar to the previous one. So you can get Cn from here, just lambda n will be different from the previous problem. So only difference with the previous problem is the eigenvalue, otherwise the structure of the problem is very very similar. So to summarize what we have discussed today, we have discussed about some unsteady state problems where you have the problems solvable by the method of separation of variables. So we have addressed the method of separation of variables with the help of some examples of infinite slabs. We will later on consider some examples which we call as semi-infinite problems, and we will take it up in the next lecture. Thank you very much.